Okay, at the end of the last lecture segment, I talked about, let's try and go ahead and figure out what a fair value would be for a bond that has a face value of $1,000 and a time to maturity is 1 year, when the interest rate available on equivalent alternative investments was 8%. And I said, we do that by doing a present value calculation. And the present value calculation, we do the eventual face value or future value over 1 plus the interest rate raised to the number of years. So the fair or present value here is going to be $925.93. And that's also our prediction of the eventual market price of the bond. And to see the reason for that, let's go ahead and see what would happen if this bond had a market value of $800. If I'm able to buy something for $800 and it's going to pay back $1,000 a year from now, then my gain on that investment is $200, and my rate of return, or how much money I made compared to how much money I spent, would be 25%. So, if that's true, then this thing is a huge bargain at 800 bucks. I'm able to buy something for 800 bucks and make a 25% rate of return when alternative investments are only paying 8%. So investors are going to rush in and buy this thing and push the market price up. And so $800 is not going to be an equilibrium price. And they're going to push the price up. And as they push the price up, what happens to the rate of return? Well, if they push the price up to, say, 850 bucks, then the rate of return falls to 17%. And if they push the market price up to 900 bucks, the rate of return falls to 11%. And if they push the market price up to 920 bucks, so still this thing looks like a good deal at 920 bucks. It still gives a higher rate of return, 8.7% instead of 8. But you can see, as the market value rises towards this present value, the rate of return converges to that interest rate that is available on alternative investments. So that process is going to keep on going on until we get to the market value is equal to the present value. And I didn't sort of carry out every single decimal there, but we can go ahead and tell Excel to do it for us by just copying there. So if I'm able to buy this for $925.93.5 or so, then my gain is $74 and a bit, and that will produce an 8% rate of return. Notice that if we had started with a high value here, suppose it was initially selling for 950 bucks, then our gain is relatively small, which gives us a low rate of return, and then people aren't going to be willing to buy it for 950 bucks. And if people aren't willing to buy it for 950 bucks, its price is going to fall. And its price is going to fall, and that's going to increase the rate of return. And as the price falls and increases the rate of return, eventually the rate of return is going to converge to that 8% rate of return. So that $925 price is the price that produces a rate of return equal to the 8% benchmark interest rate. So that's why that's the fair or fundamental value of that bond. Notice that we also derived an additional result here, that when we go from a relatively high price to a lower price, a fall in a bond's price produces an increase in its rate of return. It follows also that a rise in a bond's price produces a decrease in its rate of return. So that's worth noticing. When the price of an asset is higher, then, typically speaking, you're going to get less benefit from buying that asset because the gain is going to be less. We could also go ahead and play around with this interest rate. What if interest rates had been lower? Well, if interest rates are lower, then we're going to have that fair market value of that bond be higher. So, what's going to also be true is a fall in interest rates produces an increase in a bond's price. And if we had had a really high interest rate instead, then we would have had a lower price. So a rise in interest rates produces a decrease in a bond's price. And notice that each of the statements on these lines here are fundamentally equivalent. One talks about the influence of price on interest rates, the other talks about the influence of interest rates on price, but they're all consistent with each other. The last thing I want to talk about in this video segment is, what if we had a different number of years? What if we had to wait more years to get repaid our money? And you can maybe intuit that waiting a longer time to be repaid your money is a bad thing. And that's exactly what our calculations are going to show here. If we have to wait 5 years to get repaid our money, then we have to wait longer and our money is tied up in this bond for longer. So, in this case, we're going to see that the present value of this bond is going to be $680. And the way to see that is that if I buy something for $680 and it grows at 1 plus the interest rate for 5 years, so this is just a compound growth calculation. So if I put $680 in the bank and it grows at 8% for 5 years, what does it grow to? It grows to that $1,000 face value. So that, again, that present value is something that produces a rate of return equal to that benchmark interest rate. And so if we change this number of years, that's going to change things around. So we can also say that when we wait longer to receive a payment, the present value of that payment is lower. We don't like having to wait. And so how much we treat that payment as worth is lower when we have to wait longer to do it. And when we don't have to wait as long to receive a payment, the present value of that payment is higher. So in particular, we had started with a situation where we had 1 year to maturity. But let's suppose half a year has passed. Notice the price of the bond rises because we have to wait less time. Effectively, instead of like having the whole 8%, we now are only having to wait 4% because we have half a year. And as we get close to the bond's maturity date, if there's only 1/10 of a year less left till maturity, you can see that the present value of this bond is rising towards the face value. And if we got, you know, the day before or something like that, or a couple days before, you can see that the present value, the predicted market value of the bond, is nearly equal to the face value.